This is a portrait by Degas Mary Cassatt, painted about 1877. She was probably the only woman to whom Degas was ever very close. She was an American born into a wealthy family and was very well traveled and educated. By 1877, when she met Degas, she had been studying with Jerome and Couture in Paris and had exhibited at the Salon for the first time in 1868. She may have met Degas in connection with her friend Louisine Elder's purchase of his ballet rehearsal on stage here, a mixed media work that is, among other things, part watercolor and part pastel. Miss Elder would go on to marry the sugar baron, Henry Havemeyer, and they would become great benefactors of the New York Metropolitan Museum where this is. It is usually considered to be the first Impressionist picture to arrive in the U.S. There are now 1,967 works at the Met that once belonged to the Havemeyers. Degas invited her to show her pictures at the 4th Impressionist exhibit in 1879, and one of those she sent is this picture of her sister, Lydia, at the opera. She painted several pictures of women at the opera and theater at this time before turning to the domestic subjects for which she is more well known today. She was influenced by Degas' interest in pastels, and one could almost imagine this to be his work. They saw a lot of each other while working on what was supposed to be a monthly illustrated journal of prints to which others would also contribute, but nothing ever came of it. Mary blamed Degas for the failure, which put a strain on their relationship, which was further strained when she commissioned a picture from him and then he insisted she pay for it through a dealer for reasons that aren't entirely clear. This is a picture called 5 o'clock tea, which he bought from her and which was in the 5th Impressionist exhibit. The woman at the left is again thought to be her sister Lydia. It's another picture which is very Degas-like in technique. The usual thought is that although they were close, Degas was psychologically incapable of marriage and interested in women only as subjects for works of art. Her most well-known picture is probably The Child's Bath, painted in 1893 and now in the Chicago Art Institute. In 1890, a very popular exhibition of Japanese prints had been shown in Paris, and this has something of that look about it. She herself did make several dry point and aquatint prints that look even more Japanese in style than this. And from this point on, in fact, her work was to be dominated by mother-daughter subjects, though she had no children of her own. Some of the poets of 19th century France were of a very different sort of character. The most influential French poet of the 19th century was Charles Baudelaire, about whom I've spoken a couple of times already. This is a photograph of him at the age of 34, taken in 1855 by the ubiquitous Nadar. Des Esseintes, that is, Huysmans, admiration for him was, he says in A Rebours, limitless. They didn't agree about everything. Baudelaire, in fact, offers as glorious a paean to womanhood as could be in his Peintre de la Vie Moderne. He says woman is like a star, a divinity presiding over all the conceptions of the male brain, although he does allow, too, that such an idol may be empty-headed. Huysmans says that Baudelaire pushed his way along the abandoned or unexplored galleries and districts of the soul where the monstrous vegetations of the sick mind flourish. He shared with Huysmans and the symbolist poets, as they're called, the culte de moi, a kind of obsessive concern with individuality and a private inner world that rejected the real one. Certainly they turned away from the realism of writers like Hugo and Balzac for one of imagination and fantasy. As I mentioned earlier, he dedicated Les Fleurs de Mal to Théophile Gautier. He's not so well known today, although he was an important figure in the world of French literature in the mid-19th century. A poet, a dramatist, an art critic, he wrote the libretto, or most of it, for Giselle, for which Adolphe Adam wrote the music. He had a long crush on the dancer Carlotta Grisi, who lived with but was not married to the famous dancer Jules Perrault, who became the equally famous dancing master we see in several of Degas' pictures. The poems are, it's true, often about love or at least sex and death, but those have always been subjects favored by poets. Yeats said that love and death were the only good subjects for poets, and Keats told Fanny Braun that all his poetry was about her beauty and his death. It's in one of his later prose poems that one of Baudelaire's most quoted lines occurs, N'importe où hors du monde. He says he always imagines he'll be better off someplace else, but where? Indonesia, the Baltic, anywhere out of the world, N'importe où hors du monde. This, I think, could really be the motto of the symbolists. Christian Corbière, another symbolist poet, says he's homesick for a country he's never seen, which makes the same point, I guess, and a lot of these symbolist poets, in fact, became hors du monde very young. Corbière died at 29. Rambeau at 37, L'Outremont at 24. This is a portrait of Stéphane Mallarmé by Renoir. I talked about Stéphane Mallarmé earlier in connection with Manet's pictures for his translation of Poe's Raven. In Huysmans au Rebours, Des Essaints has a special edition of Mallarmé's work in fine calligraphy on parchment made. He's often considered among the most difficult poets to translate because of his interest in the sound of the words he writes, but maybe that's what has led to a lot of his poems inspiring music, including L'Après-midi d'un Faune by Debussy, which Debussy used, of course. Debussy also set several poems by Baudelaire and Verlaine to music. This is all interesting because one thing that interested most of the symbolists was synesthesia, the evocation of one kind of experience, one art form by another, for example, a musical one by a literary one. Paul Valéry, another 19th century French poet, thought that Mallarmé's few poetic gems would outlast Zola's mountain of prose, but we may not know about that for a few more centuries. This is a photograph of Stéphane Mallarmé. He thought poetry the most powerful art form. Il n'y a que la beauté, he says. There's nothing that really matters except beauty, and poetry is its most perfect expression. What I would say is that literature is the most valuable art form, but as I've said, music is the most powerful. Literature is valuable in that it allows, as Saint Benedict said, dead people to talk to us. Mallarmé, like Baudelaire and so many other French, was, as we saw earlier, a great admirer of Edgar Allan Poe and wrote an honorary epitaph for him in which he says that it's the purpose of the poet to speak for the tribe and preserve its ideas and values for the future. That is, again, if you're a writer, you can talk to people after you're dead. Degas' portrait of Gustave Moreau, a painter who is usually called a symbolist, whom he met and much admired in Italy in the late 1850s. The other prominent symbolist painter is Odillon Redon, who was little known until the publication of Huysmans au Rebours, in which Des Essaints is a big collector of his work, and in which book Moreau is also highly praised. Like many terms used to indicate styles in the history of art, symbolist has, as I've suggested, a context-sensitive meaning here and doesn't mean exactly what one would think. It's sometimes said that symbolist painting and poetry doesn't so much represent something as try to evoke an emotion. For example, Redon says, "My drawings inspire and are not to be defined. They place us, as music does, in the ambiguous realm of the undetermined." And it is common among artists in the 19th century to invoke music in describing the effect they think their paintings do or should have. This goes back to what I said just a bit ago about their interest in synesthesia. This is the Café Greco in Rome, where Moreau and Degas used to spend time, and it's still a popular rendezvous for wannabe artists, intellectuals, writers. Moreau was a pupil of Theodore Chassériot, whom Ingres considered his best pupil, but Moreau went off in his own very unique artistic way. By the time he met Degas in Italy, he had already exhibited in the Salon three times with somewhat strange but acceptable renditions of classical and biblical subjects to mixed reviews. This is the interior of the café. He had no interest in painting the contemporary world of Café Concert, the landscape at Barbizon, or indeed anything at all very real. Castagnari called his Salon pictures retrograde, primarily, I think, just because they were on traditional subjects. In 1864, he exhibited the Sphinx, which you see here, and it is often considered the first symbolist painting. The typical symbolist painting, like the typical symbolist poem, has that hors du monde quality, that interest in fantasy, imagination, dreams, and distaste for the real world, found in Baudelaire and Huysmans and their hero, Edgar Allan Poe, as well. Moreau did, to some extent, fit Huysmans' model of the reclusive aesthete, but he was also a very popular professor at the École des Beaux-Arts. Henri Matisse, Georges Rouault were both pupils of his. He seems to have kept his academic career essentially separate from the work he did in his studio, and was a great admirer of the Renaissance heroes like Michelangelo and Leonardo, whom he insisted his pupils study. To many people today, this picture seems potentially much more controversial than even Manet's Déjeuner, which had been rejected by the Salon the previous year. What Castagnari means by calling him retrograde, I think we can see, though, if we compare Moreau's work to Ingres of 30 years or so earlier. It's a strange subject, but of course a well-known classical subject, and that made a lot of difference. Castagnari was a fan of Manet and Courbet, who were not interested in this kind of subject matter at all. As bizarre as Moreau's pictures sometimes got, subject matter-wise, they were within the established tradition. The same year, he painted the Thracian girl carrying the head of Orpheus on his lyre. Orpheus was killed by the frenzied devotees of Bacchus. This could happen to Justin Bieber. But according to one version of the legend, his head continued singing after his death, and Moreau may have seen the singing head as a symbol of the poet's immortality, although this head doesn't seem to be actually singing anything. Much of Moreau's time was spent doing watercolors on paper, which were not exhibited in his lifetime, and many of which are now the property of the museum into which his studio was turned at his death. He made hundreds of them. This one, now in the Louvre, is on the subject of Phaeton, who made the mistake of driving the chariot of the sun god Helios without a license and made a desert out of North Africa by veering too close to the earth. Counting all of his oil paintings, watercolors, and drawings, his surviving corpus totals probably something like 10,000 works of art. He painted several episodes in and versions of the story of Salome, who, to make the story short, asked for the head of John the Baptist as a reward for a dance that pleased Herod. There's a certain resemblance in these to medieval manuscript decoration, maybe in the sort of jewel-like quality. He said he wanted to render flashes of the imagination visible. The Salome pictures were among the favorites of Huysmans, who says, "Nature's had her day, the same boring sky, disgusting sameness of landscape. Imagination can easily replace vulgar reality." Here are Samson and Delilah by Moreau, and we're going to hear part of Saint-Saëns' opera on this subject and see more of Moreau's pictures, mostly on the theme of Salome and John the Baptist. But we'll also see Jupiter with Semele, who made the mistake of asking to see him not as a bull or a swan or a shower of gold or in one of his many other disguises, but in his real form.
Thank you.
Jupiter in Somali was one of his last pictures and one of his most ambitious. He never traveled beyond Europe, but quite a few of his pictures have a distinctly Byzantine character, or in this case, even the look of something from India. At his death, he left his studio residence at 14 Rue de la Rochefoucauld, and thousands of works of art, including the Jupiter in Somali we just saw, to the state, and this is now the Moreau Museum. This is a bedroom. By the time Moreau was doing his most famous pictures, like the ones of Salome and the Jupiter in Somali, Degas, his former admirer, was painting from a very different point of view. Degas said that visiting Moreau's studio was like visiting a thesaurus, a lot of ways of saying or painting the same thing. But that could certainly be said about a lot of his own ballet dancers or about the work of a lot of other artists. This is a self-portrait of Odillon Redon, the other especially important symbolist. Gauguin, I should say, is sometimes called a symbolist, but more often he and Van Gogh are called post-impressionists, and Redon, in any case, certainly has more in common with Moreau than with Gauguin. He was born in Bordeaux, and after studying painting briefly in Paris, he returned there to study printmaking, and until he was 50, most of his work was graphic art in the form of lithographic prints and chalk and charcoal drawings, which he called noirs. He exhibited 15 of them at the last Impressionist Salon, but they also have little in common with the work of Monet or Degas. The Profile of Light, or the Fairy, is one of those he showed, and despite its strangeness, it's easily one of his most traditional prints. By this time, he had attracted the attention of Huysmans and also Mallarmé, who was to become one of his best friends. Maurice Denis, another symbolist painter, in fact, said that Redon was the equivalent to Mallarmé in painting. Among these early noirs is this crying spider. Huysmans said of these drawings that they passed all bounds, transgressing in a thousand ways the laws of pictorial art, utterly fantastic and revolutionary, the work of a mad and morbid genius. He compares the effect to that of Poe's work, but Poe is never this strange. This work by Redon, called Melancholy, was Huysmans' favorite by Redon, and he says that this would actually dissipate the gloom into which his protagonist, Des Esseintes, often fell, and that he, Des Esseintes, would meditate in front of it for hours. I think he probably needed to seek professional help, as they say. After about 1890, Redon quit doing these nightmarish noirs that Mallarmé and Huysmans liked and began doing delicately colored pastels like this one representing Shakespeare's Ophelia. Arthur Rimbaud and Paul Verlaine, like Baudelaire, are classified as symbolist poets, as Moreau and Redon are classified as symbolists in the visual arts. Fantin Latour included Baudelaire, as we saw in his homage to Delacroix, and Rimbaud and Verlaine are in this picture by him. Verlaine, whose appearance is very distinctive, is at the lower left, and Rimbaud is next to him. Paintings and music don't, of course, have to be translated the way poetry does, and French symbolist poetry is especially difficult, as I've suggested in the case of Mallarmé. Verlaine and Rimbaud do have quite a non-French following, though, at least in part due to their memorable biographies, I think. This is a closer view of Verlaine and Rimbaud. Rimbaud wrote almost all of his poetry before he was 21. Verlaine had a wife and child. He deserted for Rimbaud and absinthe. He shot and wounded him in a Brussels hotel argument and had to spend 2 years in prison for it, then converted to Catholicism when he got out. Giving up his writing, Rimbaud joined the Dutch army, went to Java, and immediately deserted. Eventually, he wound up in Yemen, where he assembled a harem of concubines, and then went on to Ethiopia, where he became friends with the Emperor Haile Selassie's father. He died at 37, apparently of cancer. This is a photograph of Verlaine. Most of his poetry was written after his breakup with Rimbaud, although some think his earlier writing is better than the later. He somehow managed to live into his 50s, although, like Courbet, he was apparently constantly drunk. He sits here in a Paris bar with a bottle of absinthe in front of him. Someone once said that you know you're an adult when insanity no longer seems like a desirable condition, but I'm not sure either Rambo or Verlaine ever made it. This is the address where Verlaine died in Paris, 39 Rue Descartes. Hemingway later lived here. Verlaine's poetry was frequently set to music by or inspired music by important composers like Debussy and Fauré. Surprisingly, one of Odillon Redon's biggest fans was Paul Cézanne. As I've mentioned, several of the French artists of the 19th century were born into families with quite a bit of money, and Cézanne's father and grandfather had run one of the biggest banks in Provence, and he would eventually inherit a fortune so large he might even be able to buy one of his own paintings today. In 1859, when Paul was 20, his father bought the then somewhat dilapidated 100-year-old chateau of Jazz de Buffon on a 37-acre estate here at Aix-en-Provence. This is a photograph of Cézanne taken in 1861. He attended private school in Aix and there met Emile Zola as well as another important writer, Paul Alexis. This would be like Ernest Hemingway, Pablo Picasso, and Tennessee Williams all going to the same high school in Bakersfield. In 1858, Zola moved to Paris, and in 1861, the year of this photograph, Cézanne made his first trip there, and that's probably where this photograph was taken. Like so many other artists of the day, he put in considerable time at the Studio Suisse, where he made this drawing of a model, and he met, among others, Pizarro, but he was discouraged about his prospects and returned to Aix to work in his father's bank, which, however, he found even more discouraging. So, with a small allowance, he returned to Paris in the studio of Père Suisse. This is a self-portrait he painted in 1865. He failed an attempt to enter the Academy the next year, 1862, and failed to get anything into the Salon in the famous exhibition of 1863, but did show some pictures in the Salon des Refusés, although we don't know which ones they were, and they were not mentioned at all by any of the critics. Nor do we know in most cases which pictures he submitted to the other salons preceding the first Impressionist exhibit in 1874, but in any case, they were all rejected. Even his friends commented on the violence and darkness, the brutality, as one put it, of his style at this time, and dark and brutal could certainly be used to describe this picture. By this time, Zola was writing a column on art exhibits for the influential newspaper L'Evénement, in Paris, and using language as violent as Cézanne's brushstrokes, condemned the Salon as a mass of mediocrity and accused the jury of amputating art and presenting the crowd with only the mutilated corpse. Since this resulted in a flood of subscription cancellations, he was obliged to thereafter share his duties with a more mainstream critic. Zola was never one to avoid a fight, though, and once said, "I live my life out loud." This painting by Cézanne is a picture of their friend Paul Alexis reading to Zola, done in 1869, a year which brought another Salon rejection for him. At the time this was painted, Zola had just begun work on his gigantic Rougon-Macquart series of novels, including, as I mentioned earlier, L'Assommoir and Germinal, as well as La Curée, which is now also very popular with Zola fans. Alexis was an important journalist and is especially valuable today for his biography of Zola. He was a member of the group which included Huysmans and Guy de Maupassant, which often visited Zola at his big Medin house in the suburbs. They were known, in fact, as the Groupe de Medin. Cézanne came and went between Paris and Aix-en-Provence most of his life, and in this portrait painted back home, we see his father reading L'Evénement, Zola's column, I suppose. This also represents his dark period before he met Pizarro and the other Impressionists and began to paint landscapes. When the Franco-Prussian War broke out in 1870, Cézanne went back to Provence with a girl named Hortense Fiquet, with whom he would live and by whom he would have a son before they were finally married in 1886. His father would die the same year, making Suzanne a rich man. Looking into the future, this is a portrait Suzanne painted of her that year, by which time they'd been living together for more or less 15 years. The main reason on Suzanne's side for the marriage seems to have been the desire to legitimize his son, and it is generally thought that Hortense and Paul were not good soulmates. She did not like Provence, and she did not like his paintings. Of her, he once said, "She only liked Switzerland and lemonade." After they were married, she spent most of her time in Paris when Suzanne was in the South. His friends referred to her as the ball and chain, but he did paint her portrait 40 times. During the war, they lived for some time at Lestac near Marseille, and this is one of many pictures Suzanne painted of the area, which he visited several times over the rest of his life. Before his first visit here in 1870, he had not done much in the way of landscape painting. But after the war, he visited Pizarro in Pontoise, just down the river from Paris, about 10 miles farther than Argenteuil, and came under the influence of his way of painting landscape, and his favorite colors, which had been, as I said, dark, became much lighter. This was one of the pictures, called The House of the Hanged Man, he entered in the first Impressionist show in 1874, having been encouraged to exhibit with the group by Pizarro, and it was bought for 300 francs. Pizarro was always the painter Suzanne regarded as the most important of the Impressionists, and the one from whom he learned the most, and it is sometimes difficult to tell whether a picture is by one or the other. Suzanne also met Renoir about this time, and through him, Victor Choquet, of whom he painted this portrait, and who bought several of his paintings, from the dealer known as Père Dangy, like Gachet, also a friend of Van Gogh's, who for many years would be the only dealer to exhibit his work. This portrait was exhibited in the 1877 Impressionist show, along with 15 other works, which were mostly landscapes and still lifes, but it was to be the second and last time Suzanne would join them. This picture was singled out for particular criticism by most of the reviewers, and it was referred to by one as looking like an old shoe. This is a photograph of Suzanne, who had never been very sociable, and when he visited the fashionable cafes which were frequented by most of the Impressionists in the 70s and 80s, he often went unrecognized. He acquired the reputation of a boorish loner, and he did, like Zola, have strong opinions. He threatened to wring Gauguin's neck and didn't like Van Gogh or Degas. He was a de facto character in two novels, one by Durante that isn't important, and one by Zola, Louvre, called The Masterpiece in English, which caused Suzanne to end their lifelong friendship in 1885. By the time this was written, Zola had in fact written quite a few things about Impressionism, which had also irritated Renoir and Pizarro, among others. This is the picture known as the self-portrait in the white turban, done about 1880, and from this point on, Suzanne became something of a recluse, spending much of his time in Provence living with his mother at Jazz de Buffon. In 1894, he visited Monet at Giverny and met Mary Cassatt, who said he looked like a cutthroat, but in fact had the gentlest nature possible. Nevertheless, he left in a huff over an imagined insult, and back in Provence began behaving in such a way as to have most of his friends question his sanity. He also revised his will, disinheriting his wife Hortense, with whom he hadn't gotten along for years. He apparently suffered from diabetes, and this has been blamed for some of his eccentricities. It was at this time, however, that he painted many of his most well-known pictures, including the card players. There are several versions of this. And he also at this time painted a lot of his 60-odd views of Mont Saint-Victoire and many of his 100 or so still lifes. Genre subjects like the card players were not, however, things he painted very often, and people are also rarely visible in his landscapes. After the death of Père Tanguy in 1894, the soon-to-be famous dealer Ambrose Vollard, of whom this is a portrait by Cézanne, persuaded Suzanne to let him mount a one-man show of his work in Paris, and Suzanne sent 150 paintings. It opened late the following year to predictably mixed reviews, which did not please Cezanne, though many of the pictures were sold. After Victor Choquet died, his collection of 32 Cezannes brought 51,000 francs, and the House of the Hanged Man alone sold for 6,000. This still life was one of those in the Vollard exhibition. Some of his still lifes look more arranged than others, but some who saw him at work on them said he positioned everything very carefully. He painted still lifes regularly from the mid-1860s on. Pierre Schneider says he treated his still life subjects as indoor landscapes. This one, Bread and Eggs, done in 1865, is one of the earliest and is, as you could probably guess from his early dark period, it almost actually looks like something Manet might have painted in his Spanish period, or else like something by Velázquez himself at about the age of 18. As I suggested a minute ago, he painted far more still lifes than any of his contemporaries. His first flower still life wasn't done until much later. This is one of the earliest of those, done about 1875. He is always lumped together with Van Gogh and Gauguin Seurat, as I've mentioned, as a post-impressionist, but he didn't really like any of them or their work, and his own paintings have little in common with what any of them did. I mentioned his threat to strangle Gauguin. When he met Van Gogh by chance at Père Tanguy's, he told him in all sincerity, "You paint like a madman," which could be viewed as perceptive, I guess. I mentioned earlier that one of the few artists contemporary with him besides Pizarro for whom he expressed much admiration was Odéon Redon, and this is kind of what one might think of as a more masculine version of one of Redon's flower pictures. This is a picture he painted of Jazz de Buffon now, his family home, of which we saw a modern photo earlier. He visited it and painted it many times over the course of his career, but after his mother's death here, he had to sell it. This is another view of it by him. He came across to most people, and perhaps especially to the people of X, as I've suggested, as a half-mad eccentric, but he was very well-read, and when he wanted to, could discuss Conor Schopenhauer, Balzac, or Zola. And he knew most of Baudelaire's Fleur de Mal by heart. In 1903, he finished a new studio house and began using what's now known as the Cezanne Studio at Les Loves outside Aix, but he only used it really during the last 3 years or so of his life. He was probably the most influential of all the late 19th century painters. Nabis, Fauves, Dadaists, Cubists, all were to acknowledge a debt to him, whereas the Impressionism of Monet and Pizarro came to be regarded as old-fashioned by the new avant-garde. This is the way the interior of the studio looks today, more or less as he left it when he died in 1906. Over the course of his career, he painted Mont Saint-Victoire, which can be seen from the place, about 60 times, as I said. It's not an especially high mountain, about 3,300 feet, but it stands out impressively because the country around it is so flat. It is also associated with all sorts of legends, going all the way back to the 1st century BC massacre of the Teutons by Marius and the Romans, which took place on the plain to the south of it, to the right in Cezanne's paintings of it. We'll see some of his views of it in a minute. But this is a photo of Gabriel Fauré, whose Pavane is one of the most well-known pieces of 19th century music. It was dedicated to the Countess de Grefful, whose salon was perhaps the most well-known in Paris at the end of the 19th century. She is thought by many to have been the model for the Duchesse de Guermantes in Proust. "She was long in unrequited love," says gossip anyway, "with the homosexual, or at least bisexual, Roberto Montesquieu, who is himself thought to have been the model for Proust's Baron de Charlus." This portrait is by Alexius de Laszlo, who became the go-to portrait painter for the people who frequented the Countess's salon. She was one of Gustave Moreau's steady supporters, and of Whistler as well. We'll hear Fauré's Pavane, which, as I said, was dedicated to her, and see some of Cezanne's many pictures of Mont Saint-Victoire now, most of them painted near the end of his life. Thank you. Cezanne himself was almost entirely apolitical, but one of the things for which his longtime friend Emile Zola is remembered is his involvement in the Dreyfus Affair. In 1894, the Jewish French army officer, Alfred Dreyfus, and you see a photograph of him here, was accused of giving French military information to the Germans. Without going into details, the essence of the matter is that the charges against him were fabricated, and in 1895, he was sentenced to be exiled to Devil's Island, the French penal colony off the coast of South America. Then, when it became clear that the evidence against him was phony, the authorities engaged in a cover-up. On January 13, 1898, Zola published his famous defense of Dreyfus on the front page of the future Prime Minister Georges Clemenceau's newspaper, L'Aurore. This was not the first attempt to exonerate him, but Zola was a very influential writer, of course, and it's his defense that's remembered. In exchange for the honor of being Dreyfus's most out-front defender, he was sued for libel, found guilty, and forced to go to England until a change in government allowed his return 6 months later. Dreyfus himself was finally pardoned by the new French president, Emile Loubet, returned to France, and fought in the First World War. Julia Louis Dreyfus is a distant relative of his and is the daughter of Gerald Louis Dreyfus, one of the richest men in the world, so I hope you didn't feel sorry for her when Seinfeld ended. Richard Dreyfus here is also a distant relative and bears a distinct resemblance to Alfred. This is a photograph which Degas took of Mallarmé and Renoir in 1890. We tend to think of artists, or at least people who call themselves artists today, as a pretty liberal bunch, but many of the painters of this period were not that supportive of Zola and Dreyfus. Monet was, as was Mallarmé here, but Renoir said some anti-Semitic things, and although they'd been friendly before the Dreyfus affair, after the controversy broke, there is some evidence he didn't even want his pictures displayed with works by Pizarro, who supported Dreyfus and who was nominally Jewish himself. This is a portrait by Manet of one of the real characters of the age, Henri Rochefort. Manet died before the Dreyfus affair, but in the 1870s he was a great admirer of Rochefort, and Rochefort was, like Dreyfus himself, sent to a penal colony at the ends of the earth, in his case New Caledonia, for his involvement with the Communards in 1871. He eventually escaped in 1874 on a ship to San Francisco, an episode commemorated in this picture by Manet. But after being allowed to return to France in 1880, he veered now from left wing to right and became one of the most vehement anti-Dreyfusards, and at the same time also one of Cezanne's most outspoken critics, in part because he thought of him as a friend of the arch-Dreyfusard Zola, even though the two hadn't spoken to one another for years. Zola died himself somewhat mysteriously of carbon monoxide poisoning caused by a stopped chimney. Rochefort claimed he'd committed suicide after discovering that Dreyfus was guilty after all, though even he can hardly have really believed that. It's in fact often argued he was murdered by his political enemies who plugged the chimney. When Rochefort died in 1913, he was buried here in the Montparnasse Cemetery. On the other hand, Zola is buried here, which would seem to show that the French can get it right sometimes. However, Dreyfus himself is not buried here. He's buried under a plain stone just a few yards from Rochefort in the same cemetery. Okay, that's where we'll wind up today. Next week, the last week, we'll hear mostly about Renoir, Gauguin, and Van Gogh.